Good evening. Welcome to Math Homework Hotline, where we're going to thrill you and chill you with some magical math and some formulas. Lots of formulas tonight. I am your co-host, Vicki Viverito, and my other co-host,
Hanna, everybody. Welcome to Math Homework Hotline.
Oh my goodness. It must be Halloween time.
It is.
Or maybe Thanksgiving. Because that sure looks like a what, Mr. Hanna?
Following each other. Very soon we'll have those big events.
Because I think that's a pumpkin pie.
You said pie?
I did.
Oh, we have tons of pies today.
So okay, so we have lots
ready to
of
enjoy.
Pie.
That's true.
Okay. Maybe we have some cherry. I like cherry. So if you have questions about your homework tonight, and we will take them seriously, you can just call us. Our number is 840-7260, and you can see us on TV, or if you have to be away from the television, you can stream us on your mobile devices at mhh.mysdhc.org. So give us a call or stream us, but let's see what we're going to be talking about tonight and why we're talking about pi. Ah, so tonight's topic is volume, and we're going to explore volume dealing with pyramids, prisms, cylinders, spheres, and cones. So now I know why Mr. Hanna said pi was going to be involved. And now it's time for Mr. Hanna to introduce the challenge problem. So you get ready, and let's see if Mr. Hanna can challenge you and you can meet his challenge. I'm sure they can, Mr. Hanna.
Oh yeah, they do every time they meet our challenge and impress us with what they know of mathematics. And tonight, no difference. You're going to impress us one more time. Tonight's show is about what? Volumes, right? Let's see if we can figure out the volume of this next challenge question. Let's take it. It says here, calculate nothing other than the volume. Yes. Calculate the volume of this composite solid figure. Yes, we call it composite solid figure when it is more than one figure as an individual figure. Like you see a pyramid there. No, not a pyramid, sorry. You see a cone, a circular cone. You see a cylinder. You see a hemisphere. All of them glued together to make that one composite figure. We want you to figure out the volume of that whole one as one piece, one body, okay? Look at the numbers, and I would advise that you take a picture of it as you can work on your own piece. You take a look at this length is all 16, one piece, and then the height of the cone itself is only 5, and then on the other side where the hemisphere is, it was only 6. I'm sure you took a picture of it. If you have not done so, let us know. We can put it back again one more time for you. All right, work on it and call us. The first caller with the right answer will be announced as our challenge question winner for tonight, and that could be you. We're waiting for you, your call. Give us a call, waiting for you. Back to you, Vicki.
Thank you. Now, before we get started, I have a few goodies to give away, and you don't even have to say trick or treat tonight. I have Math Homework Hotline t-shirts to give away, and we will be giving 6 away to people who call us and ask us questions about math. So I will announce. Okay, they don't have to be that frightening a question about math, but we'll announce at the halfway mark, and then we'll announce at the end of the show those students who have won our t-shirts. So since we're going to be talking about volume, before I get started talking about volume, one of the things that I think is most confusing about volume is naming the shapes. So one of the types of shapes we said we were going to talk about are prisms. So I have examples of 2 prisms here. And what you will notice about prisms is they have 2 faces that are exactly identical, and then the remaining faces are all rectangles. So if we look at this, we have faces that are rectangles, but if you look here, we have 2 faces that are also identical. Now, these faces are actually called the base of the prism. So these are referred to as the base. Now the base is very important in volume, so it helps to know how to name your prisms. So let's go to my board and do a little review from elementary school on what is the name of that prism. And don't peek, you're getting ahead of yourself. All right, so if we look at this first prism, if you look at it, you may say, well, wait a minute, I see all rectangles. Yes, you do, because this is what we call a rectangular prism. Now, if you work at Amazon, you just call it a shipping box, but that's exactly what that is. It's a rectangular prism, and we think of it as a box. When we come to this next one, notice we see two shapes that are the same, and then the remaining shapes are rectangles, so this is a triangular prism. That means it's based on a triangle. When I come down here, this is sort of an unusual one. We don't see necessarily a lot of these, although you may think of this as the shape of a house. And if you see, we have rectangle, rectangle all the way around, but this shape is a pentagon. So it's a pentagonal prism, or a pentagonal prism. It's just all in how you want to pronounce it. And then our last one that I'm going to look at, once again, you notice all those rectangles around, but then there's a hexagon here and a hexagon here. So this is a hexagonal or hexagonal prism. And it's important that you know the names, because when we get into our formulas, we're going to be talking a lot about the base, the base, the base. So I always think of it as it's the shape the figure is based on. For example, this is based on a triangle. That's why it's a triangular prism. This is based on a hexagon, so it's a hexagonal prism. So we're going to look at that in a little more detail, but I'm going to turn it over to Hanna right now because I need to get a few things together to get ready to talk about what exactly is volume and how do we calculate volume. So Mr. Hanna, I see you have...
I have
two-dimensional shapes.
Yes, I do have. Well, they are two-dimensional. We call them the nets. Every one of these is the net of a solid or a prism or a pyramid or a cone, as we will see different ones. Here, this one, the yellow one here, everybody, is what we call the net for a cube. Cube is a special case of a rectangular prism. This purple one is a rectangular prism. These are the four faces that Vicki was talking about. Here they are, one, two, three, four rectangles. And these two, this one and this one, are called the bases. See, base, another base. When you straighten it, when you flatten it, it shows the net. This is how it is originally cut out of a cardboard or some. And then you fold and fold and make your rectangular prism. This rectangular prism can sit on this little square as a base, can sit like this, as this is the base, or it can sit also on one of those faces as a base as well. So it's a kind of like multi-purpose rectangular prism. This cube here is a special case of this. Why? Because all those edges are congruent and all these faces are all congruent faces also. You fold, you fold, you fold, and you get this cube here. But all these six faces, everybody, are all congruent squares. Okay? Now, I'm gonna share with you the rest of this family. That, and I call them family because they have one formula for their volume, okay? Bear with me. You're gonna be impressed in just a minute as I will show you different members of that family. This one here is called a pentagonal prism, like the one Vicki showed us on her board. Here are five of these rectangles fold together, and then the two congruent bases would fold, and this would show a pentagonal prism, okay? What does this have to do with the other two I showed you? And what does this guy have to do with that family here? All of these have the same family, or they belong to the same family. Even this is a hexagonal prism. And this is a triangular prism, like the one Vicki showed us also. If you fold, see, fold, you get a triangular prism. The bases are triangles, and these are the three walls, the three lateral faces. Here is the hexagonal one. You fold, and all of a sudden you get a hexagonal prism. See, very fun to do. Now, what is so good about this family here, why we call them a family to start with, even though they are all different, I tell you this. There is one more I want to include with this family also. This is Miss Cylinder. Miss Cylinder is also part of this family here. Watch. If we fold it, and here is Miss Cylinder. Look how cute it is. Now, what does the cylinder with the circle have to do with this family of prisms? I say it's the formula for the volume. All of these figures I shared with you right now have that one formula for volume, and that is the uppercase B times the height. You say, well, what's this uppercase B, Hanna? I say this is the area of the base. Area of what? Base. Once, that's why Vicki emphasized on that word base a lot, and I do also, because once you have the uppercase B, which is the area of the base, you multiply it by the height, and here is the height for this cylinder. It's this here. It's actually going from this center here to this center here, you notice, and it's the same as this lateral edge here. There's no edge, but the same height here. Okay, so if you take this uppercase B, which is the area of that one circle here, and you multiply it by this height here, you will get the volume right away. All right, everybody? For this, yeah, you get the area of this guy as it is acting the base, then you multiply it by this height here, and you get the volume there. Same here. Area of this guy, area of this, for example, let's consider this the base, because they're all congruent anyway. So everyone and any one of them could work as a base. You get the area of this base and multiply it by this height here, which is this edge here, like this, okay? Then it will give you the volume of, and here, same thing. You get the area of this base, because it's a triangular prism, and then multiply it by the height, which is this edge here, and you're set, you get the volume. Same here, area of the hexagon, multiply by the height, you're set, you get the volume. Pentagonal prism, no change. Area of the pentagonal base times this height, and you're set, you get the volume. All of them have that same one rule for all, and that is the uppercase B times H, everybody. What a wonderful, simple rule to apply and to memorize for all of those. Now, after after a while, I will come back with you and share with you the other set of the figures with their nets, and that will, you know, make you connect between the volume of this family in particular with the uppercase B times H, and the next family, which we'll share with you in just a second, after Vicki presents a little piece that she has to present. We will go then from this family to the second family, which are like, you know, very taken from this mother family. This is like the mother family, and the other family would be like the children of those members. We'll see how this goes in just a few minutes. Vicki, back to you.
Thank you. So Mr. Hanna talked about the formula, and I'm going to talk about why that's the formula. So let's start with talking about volume itself. What are we really measuring when we are measuring volume? Now, we've talked about area before, and when we measure area, we know that we're talking about measuring the space inside of a figure. So, for example, if we were talking about the area of, let's make it something simple like a rectangle, and this is 3 by 2, what we're literally doing is cutting it into rows and columns to say, oh, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and these are all squares. So that's considered 6 square units, whatever our units are. Now, it's very similar for a three-dimensional figure, and this is actually a cube, so let me hold it so you can see it. except instead of using squares, we have to use cubes, because not only do we want to cover the base, but we need to fill this cube up. And so to measure its volume, what I'm literally doing is I'm trying to figure out how many of these cubes fit inside. So I could fill up a cube with cubes, that's pretty easy. But what happens if instead of a cube, I give you something like, oh, I don't know, a triangular prism? Now all of a sudden we're dealing with something a little different. So, well, how do you get cubes in there? You're right, cubes don't fit well. Let's try water, and I don't know how well you can see this. So if we start to fill this with water, we can't see that at all, can we? That's a little bit better. But you get the general idea. If you start to fill this with water, what you notice is the first thing the water does is it spreads out and it covers the base of that figure. And then as I continue to fill it with water, what the water does is the water begins to rise. So the first thing the water did was it covered the base of the figure, and then it rose to fill up the figure. So let's think about that in terms of that formula that we just looked at, which was, oh good, you're going to watch me spill water. Which was that the base and the height. So here's the, oh, we're going back and forth. Okay, I'm good. We can go back to the board. So the formula was that we had the area of the base, and I know you're probably thinking, why is she hiding this? I have a picture under there. So the volume that Mr. Hanna talked to us about was a capital B for base, and this is its area, times the height. Because what literally happens is if you fill something up, and water's a good example because it fills it nicely, you wind up covering the base, and remember, covering is area, and then it continues to rise until it reaches the maximum height of that figure. So let's look at a figure and see if we can use this formula to find its volume. So let me clear a few things out on our board. And remember how I said it was important to be able to name the figure, and I'm going to show you why. This figure is, very good, a triangular prism. The problem is if I wanted to pour water in it right now, it's not resting on its base. So I need you to think about what would it look like if I had it rest on its base, or what is its base shape? Well, if I come over here and outline it, I see that the base of this is a triangle. And can you see this triangle separate from the rest of the figure? So think about, we're trying to find the volume of a triangular prism, and the capital B is the area. Since I know it's a triangular prism, its area is 1/2 the base times the height of the triangle. And then it's times, this is where it gets confusing, I like to use a capital H because it's the height of the whole prism. So it gets a little confusing because we use lots of bases and heights. Lowercase usually refer to two-dimensional figures, and uppercase refer to three-dimensional figures. Not always, but usually. So, in this case, the base of just the triangle is 12, and the height of just the triangle is 8. Now, we said this isn't resting on its base. It's a lazy triangular prism. It's laying down. So if I were to tell this triangular prism, hey, stand up, and it stood up on its base, I want you to think about how tall it would be. That's right. It would be 15 meters tall. Here's the really cool part of the volume formula for prisms. Once you get all your numbers together, all you have to do is pick up your calculator and calculate. So 1/2, which I'm going to use decimal, 5/10 times 12 times 8 times 15 equals, and I get 720 Notice that this is M, and M represents meters. And remember what we talked about. We talked about the fact that we measure in cubes. So it's actually meters cubed. What this means is if I drew this, if I had this actually made at the right dimensions, it would take 720 cubes, and meter cubes are big, to fill the whole thing up. So now you've seen why the formula is, and we've applied the formula. Let me turn it over to Mr. Hanna, because I think he's going to take us from prisms to a different type of figure, and I bet the formula is the same.
Well, yeah, they have the same formula, but their formula is different than the other family that we just covered.
Ah.
Yeah, because now these are the children, okay? We covered the parents and grandparents. These are now the children. First child is this cone here, the circular cone, and you see how the circular cone is, like this. Here it is. Here's a circular cone. See the net? And here's the circular cone. This is the child. Who's the parent of this child? It is basically the cylinder. Here's the cone. Here it is. And here is the parent. The parent is actually this cylinder here. Okay? If I have the cylinder covered with the plastic cover also, look how they relate. They have the same base and they have the same height. See? Because they have the same base and the same height, we call this the child of this. How do their volumes relate together? Well, believe it or not, if you'll fill this with water and emptied it here, this child would be filled three times to fill this parent up. You see? Three sharp, not 3 point sum or not 2 point sum. It's exactly three, okay? That's why if this cylinder has a volume of 300 cubic meter, then this would have a volume of the child now. I'm talking about the cone, the circular cone, would have a volume of 100. Take one third of the 300. You see that? Now, this is one parent and child. Now, this one here is a net for a pyramid. Look, this is the base, square pyramid, square base. Then you fold and fold and fold, and that's exactly what that square pyramid looks like, you see? Now, if you have this pyramid here, here's the pyramid, okay? Now, here is the parent of this pyramid, this cube here, see? It's a cube. Look how if I put this child in that parent cube, watch what happens. They would have the same base, yes, indeed, and they would have the same height, which is this same edge here. Now, because they do, then if you fill this up three times and empty it here, it will fill it up completely and to the very top of it. The very, no extras and no less, no additions and no less amount of water or rice, whatever you use to fill this up. Means the relation three times is still valid. This three times this would take care of the volume here. Or if I have this parent, I can divide the volume by three and I get the volume of the child, which is this pyramid here. All right, everybody? And same for, I don't want to just repeat myself, but here is a pentagonal pyramid and its parent, the pentagonal prism, a triangular pyramid, here you go, and its parent, the triangular prism, and a hexagonal pyramid, and its parent, a hexagonal prism. Believe it or not, this one-third relationship is still valid. For the volume of any of these that I just shared with you would be that one-third of the volume of the parent, which is the uppercase B times the height of this. The height of this cone or pyramid would always be the H, the lowercase, B, uppercase B is the area of that cone or that pyramid, and then you take one-third of that, because if I cover the one-third, I'm getting the parent volume or the volume of the parent. Now we agreed that if we divided that by three, and that's multiplying by one-third means the same as dividing by three, you get the volume of the child, okay? I'm going to take you very quickly to an application. Say this, let's say this triangular pyramid here. If I tell you that this triangular pyramid here has this base here, the uppercase B, equals 24 cubic centimeter, and the height of the pyramid is given to us, h is given to us, the lowercase h is given to us as 20 centimeter. So the uppercase B would equal 24 centimeter, not cubic centimeter, I meant to say square centimeter, sorry if I mistaked. I said 24 centimeters squared. I meant to say squared, not cube. This is uppercase B is 24 centimeters squared. The height is 20 centimeter. Hanna, go find the volume of this pyramid, of this triangular pyramid. The volume would be 1/3 uppercase B H. That is 1/3. Uppercase B is now 24 centimeters squared. I forgot to put the power 2 centimeters squared. 24 centimeters squared times the h, which is 20 centimeter. And I want you to notice something here. This 1/3 would remain 1/3 for a second. But besides the point of 1/3 and the numbers, I want you to look at the unit. Centimeter squared times centimeter, this would generate the centimeter to the power 3, which we say centimeter cube. So this came from the 2 plus 1. There is 1 here, 2 here. They add up to 3 like any other exponents business. When you multiply, you add the exponents. Once the two bases are the same, centimeter, centimeter. Now, how do you get rid of the 1/3 here? That 1/3 and 24, 1/3 of 24 is 8. And 8 times 20, everybody, is 160. So this would be the volume of this triangular pyramid, everybody. We call it triangular pyramid because the base is a triangle. And we name it according to its base. All right? All right, back to you, Vicki.
Okay.
What do you got?
I have treats.
All right.
So it is time to give away some t-shirts. So those of you who are wondering exactly what you were going to wear on Halloween, now you have a costume to be a scary mathematician. And our winners of our t-shirts in the first round are Logan from Barrington. Lavarius from Benito, and Hayden from Martinez. Congratulations to our t-shirt winners, and those t-shirts will go out tomorrow, so you should have them in time to do a little trick-or-treating. All right, so we've been talking about volume, and Mr. Hanna started talking about prisms. So I'm going to go ahead and, he started talking about pyramids, but I'm going to do a little problem about a prism, because this is one of the trickiest problems that I see students have trouble with, and I'm not sure why. Cedric's aquarium is 15 inches high and has a base of 300 square inches. He won't fill it to the top, because as you know, you need to put stuff in the top. He wants to leave 1.5 inches at the top. How many cubic inches of water will he use? So I'm going to go ahead and text Mark. So the first thing I notice is, my question is, how many cubic inches of water will he use? So my job is to figure out how many cubic inches. This is a clue, because if you remember, we talked about cubic means we're dealing with volume. We're filling it with cubes. We're dealing with volume. The aquarium is 15 inches high, and it has a base of 300 square inches. Ooh, that's going to come in handy. Now, it says he won't fill it to the top. I don't need to text mark that. He wants to leave 1.5 inches at the top. So let me start by labeling. It said the height was 15 inches. And it said the area of the base is 300 square inches. What that is telling me is the base of this aquarium, that whole base right there, is 300 square inches. So let me go to my volume formula. And my volume formula, remember, was volume equals the area of the base shape times, and I'm going to use capital H because I want the height of the whole prism. So in the volume, the area of the base shape, well, this is a rectangular prism. It's based on a rectangle, and they already told me a base of 300 square inches. So I already know that the volume, the base, the area of the base is 300. That's square inches. Times the height of the aquarium. Now, we might be tempted to just put in 15, and that's what I see a lot of people do, but remember, that's not how high he's going to fill the water. And we did an example where we showed we pour the water in and it fills and rises. But he doesn't want to keep filling until it gets all the way to the top. Remember that he wants to leave a 1.5 inches at the top. So this little segment right here is 1.5 inches. That's not going to get water. So instead of saying my height is 15, the whole height of the aquarium, I'm going to take off this 1.5 inches because I only want the height of the water. And when I do that, I get 13.5 inches. So this is where I get to pull out my trusty calculator. And I have 300 times, and I don't have one of your fancy calculators, so I'm going to do 13.5. is equal to 4,500. Now notice what we have. We have inches squared times inches again. That means that's inches times inches 4,050? Times inches, which is inches, 4,050, thank you.
You're welcome.
Inches cubed. So the volume of water that we need is 4,050 inches cubed. We don't want to fill the whole thing. That's not the volume of the aquarium. That's how much water we need. All right, I think that it is time for a little magic.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
And the magician is ready.
Okay, so you have a trick for us. Yes, I gave a treat, and now you have a trick.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, last time we, if you remember well, we showed you how we can find out about your phone number. Okay, we did that trick, and I hope you played it with your friends and family and enjoyed it together. Today, I'm gonna show you how I can find out about not only your birth date, but also your age. Okay, let's take a look. We have here, are you ready to play it with me, Vicki?
I'm ready.
Okay, all right, everybody, play it with me along the way also. You're gonna have fun with it, okay. It says this, and I'm going to write it so you can have it on the video. Whenever you want to access it, you can play it with your friends from there. I want you to put 4 digits, 2 for the month of your birth, month, day. So that would be, say somebody is born in November the 13th, then that would be 11/13.
Wait, Mr. Hanna, I'm born in February.
Okay, then that's 02.
And on the 3rd?
Then that's 03.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, if it is one digit, single digit, we can make it double by putting 0 for the 10th place. Yeah, or the 10th place. All right, everybody. Month, day. Put 2 digits for the month and 2 digits for the day. Take this 4-digit number and go ahead and multiply it by 2. Don't tell anybody what's your month of birth and what's your day of birth. Don't tell anybody about that. Just wait. Then add 5 to whatever result you have. Got it? Are you there?
I'm there.
Okay. We're going to get to a part where Vicki would quit on me. I know that for sure. Now we're going to multiply by 50, Vicki. Everybody, multiply whatever result you have so far, multiply that by 50. And then you say to the person, add your age. Don't tell me about it, just add it. And after you add your age, subtract, this is the last step, subtract 250 from that. So you put four-digit number, that's two-digit for the month of birth, two-digit for the day of birth. You multiply that four-digit number by two, you add five, then multiply the result by 50, 50, then add your age. After you add your age, take that final result, take away from it, subtract from it 250. I know, Vicki, you're okay. Good job. Good job. So you added that, and now, all right. I like that. Now, after you subtracted 50, you will end with six digits. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay? And if you ended with 5 only, I know some cases would do. If you ended with 5 digits only, that's very okay also. You just put 0 here. You add 1 digit, which is a 0. Okay? Now, what does this 6 digit stand for? Well, here, this is your month of birth. This is your day of birth. And this is your age. So if I did this game with you, and I said, just please lend me your calculator for a second, I can look at this final six-digit number and know exactly what month you were born, what day of that month you were born, and how old you are to the very perfect level. I hope it worked with you. If it did not work with you, try it again. Maybe you missed a step or so. You have the video for sure. You can listen to it and watch it and play it several times until you get the hang of it. Once you get the hang of it, you play it with your friends and family and let them know the secret of where you watch that Math Homework Hotline. All right? Spread the word, everybody, about the magic trick and make people excited about how they can watch the Math Homework Hotline and enjoy those magic tricks every single time. Hope you enjoyed it.
And mine did work, Mr. Hanna, but I'm not using my own age. I used my daughter's, and that's her birth month, her birthday, and her age right now.
Great.
So it did work. Great. He was so confused because he knows how really, really, really old I am, and that wasn't working for him.
You're not old, Vicki. Come on. All right, everybody. Hope you enjoyed the trip.
So Mr. Hanna was talking to you about prisms compared to pyramids, and he was explaining that it's a third. So I actually am going to get my water back out. I am brave today, and we're going to do that. But I'm going to ask the guys to go ahead and I think we may want to keep it up here, and I'll just do the best I can. All right, so the first thing I want you to notice about these two figures is they are exactly the same height. So that's important that they're the same height. The other thing I want you to notice is that their bases are identical. See how they line up perfectly and they make sort of a little house right here? So I have a nice little house. Now remember, Hanna promised us, if they have the same height and they have the same base, this should fit in here 3 times. So we're going to test his theory. So here we go. Filling it up with 1. So there's 1. And if I stop and look at that, I'm trying to see where the best background is. No, not that way. Maybe that way is a little bit better. So there's my line. Do we really think that's going to be 3? Does that look like it's about a third of the way up? I think it kind of does. He said we could do it 3 times. So that's 1. That's 2. Oh, it's getting close, Mr. Hanna. I don't know if we're going to make it. Do we have a mop on the set?
Of course.
Oh, okay. Good. All right. And finally, there's our third. And whoa, that was close, but it did make it. He's exactly right. It takes.
Wow.
Yeah. So as long as you have a matching base and height, it takes 3 pyramids to fill 1 prism. Therefore, a pyramid is 1/3 of its matching prism. And Mr. Hanna, do you have something for us?
Of course I do.
Okay.
We're gonna do, apply actually the same concept you just covered with us, but instead of a pyramid and a prism that matches it, we're gonna deal with some cone, circular cone, and find its volume as well as part of the challenge question. Let's take a look at the challenge question, everybody. We have not received a call with a winner for the challenge question, so we're gonna do it ourselves here together. Watch carefully and see how fun it is. It's very simple. We want you to find the volume of this composite figure. This composite figure has three parts to it: a circular cone, a cylinder, and a hemisphere. We're gonna first figure out the volume, volume one. This is the volume of the circular cone, all right? Circular cone, what is your formula? Circular cone says, I am 1/3 of uppercase B, H. That is 1/3 times. Uppercase B, everybody. You can see how the base here is a circle, but I don't have its radius. For that circle, I need to find the radius, which is this red segment. This is R, lowercase r for radius. Now, for this area of the circle, which is the uppercase B, that is pi r squared. H, what is H? We're told that H here is 5, so that was given ready to go for us, or ready to. All right, so here's 1/3 pi r squared H. Finalize your arithmetic, Hanna, and do it. I say, well, let's keep pi to the very last step, everybody. We're gonna express it in terms of pi. And you say, well, why don't you put 3.14? I said, well, first reason, I want you to train for the SAT. ACT and SAT people do not want you to mess up with the value of pi. They want you to find the value of pi as pi. Okay, so don't replace it or substitute for it any value, because they believe that different people in different countries will do different values for pi. Some round it to the nearest tenth, some round it to the nearest hundredth, some round it to the nearest four digits, decimal places and stuff. So to avoid the dilemma of who's right and who's wrong and who's more accurate than who, they said just leave it pi as pi. There's no better value for pi than itself. That's why we would express our answers in pi first. Then we will take that value of pi and round it, because the question, the challenge question actually said use 3.14, so that has been set. We're gonna replace that in the very end. But until we get that, let's just put the r squared. R, what is r here? I say, well, I know that the whole diameter, here you go, is 6 centimeters. So if the whole diameter is 6, the radius, the red piece, is only a 3. So here I put 3 squared. Okay, what is 3 squared is 9. So here I have 9 pi times 5, and don't forget that 1/3. 1/3 of 9 is 3, and 3 times 5 is 15, and pi is there. So this is 15 pi centimeter cubed. This is one piece. The volume number 2, which is the cylinder, this is V2, would be the volume of the cylinder. The cylinder belongs to the parents family. Remember the parents family, which had the same formula, uppercase BH without the 1/3? Okay, so that would be B. What is the uppercase B for the cylinder? Well, it's the same base here or the same base here. Same radius? Yes, same radius. In red also, here we go. Same segment, which is the radius of the cylinder, happened to be the same as the cylinder of the child, which is the cone, and that is 3, happened to be 3, which is half the diameter, 6. So uppercase B is pi r squared. R is what? R is a 3, so it's pi times 3 squared. Times the h, what's the height of the cylinder here, everybody? Well, we are not told what's the height of the cylinder itself, but we can figure it out together. Are you ready? Let's figure the height of the whole cylinder. Watch carefully. From here, the very beginning of this solid here, all the way to the very top of it, or the very end of it, sorry, is 16. This part here is no difference. This is the radius in red, and I'm going to use the same red color to show you another radius. This is R and this is R. If this is 3, then this is 3 also. You see? So now, with this 3 taken from the 16, we have only 13 left. With this 5 taken from the 13, we have only 8 left. So, ladies and gentlemen, the height of this cylinder is 8 centimeters. You see that? And that's the H here, so that is 8 centimeters. Class. 3 squared is what? 9 times 8 is what? 72. Pi remains, and that is 72 pi centimeter cube. Let's now figure the last piece, which is the hemisphere. Yes, if it is a half a circle, we call it a semicircle. If it is a half of a sphere, we call it a hemisphere. What's the volume of a hemisphere? We're going to call it V3. The volume of a hemisphere is half the volume of a full sphere. See? Now, what's the volume of a full sphere, Hannah? It's 4/3 pi r to the third power. So you want to take half of that, Hannah? I say yes, because it's only half a sphere, not a full sphere. So what is half of 4/3? It's 2/3. And what's R of this sphere? It's the same R in red for all of them, the same radius. So that's a 3. So that would go as follows. Watch carefully. Here, that half of the 4/3 became 2/3. So it's 2/3. Pi remains pi. And 3 cubed, everybody. Have 3 fingers and tell me 3 times 3 times 3. That's what 3 cubed is. 3 times 3 is 9. Times 3 is 27. So here we go, 27. What are 2/3 of 27? Well, 1/3 of 27 is 9, and twice 9 is 18 pi. Of course, centimeter cubed. Look at these 3 boxes here, 1, 2, and 3. These are the 3 different volumes for the 3 different portions of this big guy solid. All right, so if we added all these 3 volumes, we're going to get to the volume of the whole thing. Let me change colors. So the V, just V without any subscripts here, 1, 2, and 3, we're going to just put V. V would be V1 plus V2 plus V3, and that is a 15 pi plus 72 pi plus 18 pi. 18 pi and 72 pi, we call them compatible numbers because 72 and 18 add together to good-looking 90. So they are making 90 pi together. 90 with the 15 pi, everybody, would add together to make the 105 pi. See? 105 pi centimeter cube, everybody, is the right answer for the challenge question as the volume of this composite 3-dimensional figure. Now, Hannah, can you express this answer in a different way? We say yes. If some of you would want to see the number, the answer as a decimal number, they wouldn't feel comfortable unless we get that done. So we're going to do this. We're going to say, okay, here's the 105, and multiply this by the value of pi that the question provided, which is 3.14, and this would give you the result, which is exactly 300, not exactly, of course, I would tell you why I say not exactly, 329.7 centimeter cube. You say, well, Hannah, why are you hesitant to say exactly? I say because this is not the exact value of pi. Remember, the 3.14 is a rounded value of pi. So you would never get this exact. This can be exact because now we express pi as pi. And this is one good thing other than the dilemma that we talked about, the ACT and the SAT thing. The pi itself expresses the exact value for the volume. This here would be a rounded value of the volume. So if you wanted, if the question said find the exact value of the volume, then you are forced to leave it in terms of pi. All right? Decimal answer, everybody. In terms of pi answer. Remember, the unit is centimeter cubed, and that is always the case for any volume. Hope you enjoyed the question. Hope you understood it. And if you did, share it with your friends as how to get a big volume for a big composite figure of that kind of nature. Hope you liked it. Vicki?
Okay. I'm back, but I'm giving away more stuff. I'm not giving away pumpkin pie, guys. I know. They're trying so hard. All right, so we have two t-shirts to give away now. And those two t-shirts, and I like the back because it's really colorful. Those two t-shirts will be going to Sydney at Barrington and Dalton, who is also at Barrington. So when they get to Barrington, if they want to be triplets for Halloween, they can, because I think we gave away three shirts to Barrington tonight. So, yeah, yay for Barrington. So we have been talking about prisms and pyramids, and I am going to talk about one more pyramid, and then if we have time, I may talk about a cylinder, because even though Mr. Hanna used it in his challenge problem, I want to make sure that you understand it's exactly the same concept as a prism. So I have a pyramid here on my board, and remember that we talked about when we do pyramids, pyramids are slightly different than a prism. It's still sort of the same concept. We still want to know the area of the base, because think about if we could pour water into the top of this, it would cover that base first, and then it would start to rise. So we know we want times the height of the whole figure. The problem is, as you notice, in a pyramid, instead of filling straight up, it's not like a layer cake where I'm just adding layer on layer on layer. It actually starts to narrow until it reaches a point and closes off. And so what we showed you earlier with the water is it takes three of these to make the full prism. So this isn't a prism, this is a third of that. Now the reason I picked a hexagonal prism is because guess what? When you see these on testing, they have to tell you the area of the base. That's a little less work for you to do, because remember this capital B stands for the area of the base. And right here, they already told me, capital B is 200 centimeters squared. The other factor that I need is the height, which is 21 centimeters. And then remember, because it's a pyramid, I don't leave this, I actually have to take one third of it. Now, I have a little trick I like to use. First, I use what I call the commutative property, and I'm going to move some things around. I'm going to actually move the one-third. I'm going to leave the one-third there. I'm going to move the 21. And the reason that I'm going to move the 21 is I happen to know that one-third of 21 just means to divide it by 3, and that would give me 7. Oops, that's not an equals. So now one-third of 21 is 7 times the 200, which was the area of the base. So instead of actually, if you think about it, it's filling 21 high, but when you really, if you flattened it out, it would really only be a height of about 7 here. And then 7 times 2 is 14. So without calculator, very quickly and very easily, I now know that the volume of this pyramid is 1,400 or 1,400 centimeters cubed. Because remember, volume is all about filling in with the cubes. That's the most important thing to remember about volume. It is about cubes. So, wow. Yeah. So now that we've looked at a pyramid, I'm going to hand it over to Hanna, and we're going to see what he's working on.
Oh, well, Vicki, we cannot say we covered everything on volumes unless if we cover this very practical daily exercise kind of thing. you always want to ship some boxes of a small size, and you get a big box and you put those small boxes in it, and you wonder how many of these boxes can I fit in this gigantic box. And the question here is the number of small boxes that can fit in that big gigantic box is what? Well, three steps. Step one, do it with me, is to find the volume of the small guy. You go to the small guy and say, well, you are a cube, means the area of the base is 2 by 2, that is 4, and 4 times 2, which is the height, is 8. So here's the volume of the small guy, uppercase B, H, uppercase B is a 4, times the height is also a 2, so it's 8. 8 what? 8 cubic unit, whatever that unit is. If it is inches or centimeters or whatever that is, it is going to be unit cube. This is the volume of the small guy. Or then he goes step two, everybody. That's the volume of the big guy. That's small box, big box, all right? Find this, the volume of the big guy. The big guy has also a base, uppercase B. See, it doesn't change. H. Uppercase B is what? Is it? It is an area of a rectangle. Look at the base. It's a rectangle with length 20, width 8. So it's 20 times 8. That's the uppercase B part. Then times that by the height, and the height is given to us as 10. So you basically multiply 20 times 8 times 10. I can do this in a very artistic way. Look carefully. I'm going to say, okay, 8, hold on, wait a second. Let me have 20 times 10 first. 20 times 10, everybody, is 200. When you think of 200 times 8, 200 times 8 is 1,600. So now I get this 1,600 unit cube, and that is the volume of the big guy. And guess what? Like other things in areas and stuff, to find how many of these baby box fit into this mama box here, you basically divide. So now that's step three. To get the number of boxes, you simply divide big volume over small volume. Big volume is 1,600 cubic unit by 8. That's the volume of the baby one. And 16 divided by 2, everybody, is 2. 16 divided by 8, sorry, is 2. And then the two zeros remain. And that would be the number of boxes. 200 boxes, believe it or not, can fit in this gigantic box. But the thing is, you have to go through these three steps, no exception, in order to find the answer for this question here. All right? I hope you all followed up with us, enjoyed the hour. We cannot talk enough about volumes. Give me 10 more hours, Vicki. We will continue talking about volumes and never finish it. It's a huge topic. Hope you enjoyed what we have covered and what we were able to cover. Looking forward to working with you all next time. Until then, we want you to do two things. First, share that magic trick with everybody you encounter within the next weekend. And second, spread the word about Math Homework Hotline. Go visit the website and see the archived shows as well as the current shows. Have fun and excel in math. Keep watching Math Homework Hotline.
Have a great night.
Good night, everybody.